Good evening. And welcome to our worship service this evening, as this is the first Wednesday of Advent, and we're still adjusting our new microphones around and the sound system, and we're getting a little closer each day. Tonight we come to the stable again, and as you look around each day, each time we gather, we're adding to the stable, and tonight we added a heart. And the pitchfork was over in the back, but we're going to talk about that pitchfork tonight, too. And tonight our theme is, what does the stable and our heart have in common? And I welcome you, and I pray that the Holy Spirit will work with us tonight and lead us and guide us and direct us. And so our opening hymn is the Advent of Our God. Jesus Christ came to conquer the darkness of sin and to lead us into the light of his glorious kingdom. The prophet Isaiah writes, he says, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, and those who dwell in the land of deep darkness, on them has light shining. And so let us now sing Light the Candle of Hope as we light the first Advent candle. And so enkindle our hearts with the fire of your love, that we may receive you with joy and gladness, and evermore remain steadfast in the faith, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless this wreath for use in his church throughout this holy season. Amen. Let us take time to silently and to publicly confess our sins. Lord, hear the confession of our hearts. Heavenly Father, while I hear and read your promises of hope, my sinful nature wars against my faith in you. Free me from sin that would condemn me, eternally separating me from your gracious presence. Encourage and strengthen my faith daily, that I may continually confess that Jesus is my hope. Create in me a new heart, O Lord, that I may forever believe in the incarnation of your only begotten Son. Father, forgive my grievous faults through Jesus Christ, my Lord. May his unchanging grace and righteousness govern me today and forever. And we sing one verse of O Little Town of Bethlehem. Through his incarnation, death, and resurrection, we can dare to look to the Heavenly Father for hope, grace, compassion, and forgiveness. Christ, his only begotten Son, bears the punishment we deserve and transforms our lives with his forgiveness. And therefore receive God's declaration of pure grace. And as a called and ordained servant of the Word, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are forgiven. The Heavenly Father fills us with hope, joy, and peace through Christ. Come, Lord Jesus. And we sing.
Say to the town of Judah, goes your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
The responsive reading and hope. The Lord is not only our hope, but he fills our lives with hope. As we search God's word, it is a blessing not only to hear those words, but also speak them and believe them. We come together proclaiming that Jesus Christ is our hope, based on why are you downcast in my soul?
Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God.
Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him.
And may those who fear you rejoice when they see me, for I put my hope in your word.
But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in the future.
We also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given.
Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer.
For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope.
If only for this life we have hope in Christ, in order to give it more than all men.
May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Jesus Christ is our hope.
This is the faith-producing, faith-strengthening, and hope-filled word of the Lord.
Let us stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way, a voice of one calling in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan. But John wore clothing made of camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this is what was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated for our sermon hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Thank you.
what the stable and our hearts have in common. It was the doctor's last patient on Christmas Eve. A mother came in with her young daughter and asked if he would examine her because, well, she had been showing some strange symptoms. Increase in weight, sickness most mornings, and a number of strange cravings. He checked her out very carefully and eventually told the mother that her daughter was unquestionably pregnant, at which she protested very strongly. She said, "Don't be ridiculous. My daughter has never been with a man, ever." The girl affirmed that this was true and added that she had never even so much as even kissed the man. The doctor studied the girl very carefully and then quietly stood up. He walked over to the window and stared out of it, suspecting the worst. The mother asked if there was something wrong, and he says, "No, not really." As he looked into the sky, "It must have just been a coincidence, but the last time this happened, a bright star appeared in the east." The birth of Christ is celebrated throughout the world. And yet, if we really look at it closely, little is known of the exact place or where he was born. We talk about a room in the inn, but there was no room for him in that inn. He never got in that inn, did he? Some say it was a cave, and some say it was a barn, some say it was a stable. But whatever it was, it must have been around livestock because of the use of the manger as a cradle. However, it makes little difference where Christ was born if he is not born in your heart. And tonight I want to draw a comparison between the stable Jesus was born in and the heart that beats in our bodies. And what do they have in common? Well, both our stable, the stable and our hearts, are places chosen by God for his son to be born. And why a stable? How many of you men who have had children wanted your wife to give birth of your firstborn in an unlit, dirty old stable? No crib, no nursery, no doctor, no nothing. None of us would go for that, would we? We want the best. We would pick the best hospital we could find or we could afford. But when was the last time you heard of a donkey being born in a palace, in the king's bedroom? You see, that's preposterous, but kings are born in palaces and donkeys are born in stables, but yet God allowed his son, our king, the king of kings, to be born in a lowly stable. But why? Because he wanted everyone to know they could come to the Savior. Many of the world's poor would feel unworthy to enter a palace. But everyone has no problem entering the stable. Why our hearts then? The choice of the human heart is baffling as a stable. Now, it may seem like an odd thing that God would want Jesus also be born in our hearts, but that's what the Bible teaches us. In chapter 3, Jesus was talking to a Jewish leader named Nicodemus. We looked at that account not that long ago. And he said, "I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again." Nicodemus said, "How can a man be born when he is old? Surely he cannot enter a second time into the mother's womb to be born." And what was Jesus' answer? He says, "Truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, and spirit gives birth to spirit. And you should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again." But when we try to unpack that, what he's actually saying, it says you all, including every one of us here tonight, must be born again. And then Jesus said this, "I stand at the door and knock." He's knocking at the door of our heart. He says, "If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him and be with me, and he will be with me." And that's what this stable is all about opening our hearts for Jesus. For a little 4-year-old, and having Jesus in our hearts is what makes us a Christian. And this is the testimony from 1 John 5. It says, God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. And he who has the Son has life, and he who does not have the Son of God does not have life. Four-year-old Amanda went to the doctor's office. She was running a fever. And to ease the little girl's obvious nervousness, he looked in her ears and he says, "Who's there? Who's in there? Is it Donald Duck?" And she said, "No." Then he looked up her nose and said, "Who's in there? Mickey Mouse?" And again, she said, "No." He put the stethoscope on her heart to listen and see. And he says, "Who's in there? Is it Barney?" And she says, "No! Jesus is in my heart and Barney's on my underwear." But if we think about it, our hearts and the stable are both places that need transformation, aren't they? Let's look at the stable. Stables are not known for their cleanliness. During the winter, animals are frequently confined to stables around the clock for weeks at times. Large animals never get a bath. They are messy and just go to the bathroom right where they're standing, and they step in it, they sleep in it, and without any thought about it. And you get it from the expert Barnes Steak, because I sure remember. Stables aren't supposed to stay dirty, though. They must be cleaned regularly for healthy and safety of the animals. And when I grew up, that pitchfork was my best friend. At least that's what my dad told me. And I had to pitch a lot of you know what, just to make sure that I didn't get in trouble and get into you know what. But it was something very memorable, I will tell you that. But when we look at our hearts, it's true there too. What does the Bible say? It says, from within, out of man's heart come what? Evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and make a man unclean. So who are we? We're unclean, aren't we? In Jeremiah 17, we read that the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? Let's face it, there's no place on earth worthy of God's presence. So why would God want to live in deceitful human hearts like ours? Jesus, by coming to the stable, was saying, "I'm not afraid or above entering a filthy place so that I can clean it up. That's why I've come. No heart is too dirty for me to enter, but I won't allow it to remain dirty." Have you invited Jesus into your heart? If you have, you must be ready for some radical alteration. Because, let's face it, we can't stay the way we are. And Jesus only enters hearts that are willing to change. Did you know that God didn't give us the Bible just for information? He gave us the Bible for transformation. Even Mahatma Gandhi rebuked Christians for their lack of letting the Word transform them. He said, and I quote, "You Christians have in your keeping a document that with enough dynamite in it to blow the whole of civilization to bits, to turn society upside down, to bring peace to this war-torn world. But you read it and treat it as if it was nothing but a book or good literature and nothing else." So it's not renovation or reformation, but it's a transformation. And the key to transformation is the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit of the Lord will come upon you in power, we read in 1 Samuel. And you'll be changed into a different person, it tells us. We go to the book of Ezekiel, and it says, "And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them." And that same power that changed Saul of Tarsus into Paul is there for you and me at all times. Thirdly, both are places through which God desires to reach a lost world. Think about a stable. Do you know any successful stables? The only one I can think of was the great Chicago fire of Patrick O'Leary's in 1871 that destroyed property worth $192 million people lost their lives.
What?
But that's all I can think of. But nearly everybody has heard of the city of Bethlehem. It's been successful getting the news out that the Savior was born there for centuries. The Church of Nativity, built over the site of Bethlehem, is the oldest continuous operating Christian church in the world. It was built by Emperor Constantine and his mother Helena in 339 AD over a cave or a grotto in which it is believed that the birth of Jesus occurred. It was destroyed by fire 3 centuries later, but was rebuilt into its present form in 565 AD. And millions of people travel to that church yearly to celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's telling the story. But God wants our hearts to tell that same story. 2 parents overheard their 5-year-old daughter, Lindsay's, witnessing to her friend. She told her that if she believed in Jesus and prayed, that he would forgive her sins and she would go to heaven. The little girl was convinced and prayed. The little girl looked up at Lindsay's face and said, "Will my mommy be in heaven too?" And Lindsay thought for a moment and says, "Yeah, if she believes in Jesus, but if you don't want her there, don't tell her." That sounds pretty cold, doesn't it? But by our actions, it's often what we're saying, isn't it? If God can use the stable, how about you and me? The stable had no voice to tell or to talk. It had no hands to write its story. It had no feet to travel around the world to publish the story of Jesus' birth, and yet it still proclaims it. But we have hands, and we have feet, and we have voice, and we are able to do a lot better job of telling the story than an old stable. I'm not going to let a stable or stones outwitness me. How about you? Christmas is that perfect opportunity to start a conversation about our faith in Christ. Who do you know who needs Jesus? Bring up Christmas and ask them what their traditions are. Did their family have any traditions? Ask them what Jesus means to them. Tell them what Jesus means to you. Invite them to one of the Christmas services or Advent services. Get them to come. Because the biggest news of the day, at least what the people thought, was the taxation about Quirinius, but it wasn't. It was the fact that a young Jewish woman cradled the biggest news of all, the birth of a Savior. And that still is the biggest news ever to this day. So don't pity poor Joseph and Mary. Jesus' birthplace was ordained before the foundation of the world. The prophet Micah foretold of this verse 700 years prior. But I want you to know that God has chosen your heart to dwell, for Jesus to dwell in too. So tonight, has Jesus been born in your heart? Are we letting Jesus clean up our filthy hearts? Is there some transformation taking place? And are we willing to tell the story of Jesus' birth to someone else this day, or this week, or this season? But it all begins by welcoming him in your heart. In Jesus' name. We stand as we confess the words of the Apostles' Creed. We speak the creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we sing Jesus, name above all names. And if you haven't already put your offering into play, then bring it forward at this time. will stand to pray. Let my prayer rise before you as incense.
Lifting up of my hand as the evening sacrifice.
As the day ends, O Lord, let not your spirit depart from us. Hear our prayer for forgiveness for all we have done wrong this day. Do not turn away from us, for we need your presence every hour. Let my prayers rise before you as incense. Prepare our hearts, O Lord, for the coming of the Lord. Keep us vigilant and watchful, that when he comes again in power and glory, he may find us faithful. Let my prayers rise before you as incense. Watch over our loved ones. We pray for all those who are ill, those who are absent this night. Defend them from all danger and guard them from whatever evil. Let my prayer rise before you as incense.
And the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice.
Taught by our Lord, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. Together, I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, through your Son, that you have graced us yet in this day. And I pray that you would forgive me all my sins, where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me in this life. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. It is great seeing you all here this evening and taking the time to be in the presence of the stable as that journey continues. Next Wednesday we'll be back here at the same time and bring a friend with you too. And Sunday morning we continue with it too. And this Sunday we're going to be looking at the animals that were in the stable. And I'm only going to have pictures about bringing the real animals. Receive the benediction now. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. And we close with the way of the angel.